Okay. So first of all, I have to say that unfortunately I didn't have a lot of time to prepare this talk because I didn't know, and I didn't know really what audience to expect. So I reused my talk that I was giving to students of mathematical finance in University of Chicago. And this is definitely some people with different backgrounds than you. For this reason, if I'm talking about some trivial stuff or on the other hand, forget to say something, please let me know and I will adjust correspondingly and explain things that that are not explained in slides. So please don't hesitate to ask me questions because as I already explained, I don't really know all the backgrounds that you have and you probably have very different backgrounds. So there is always stuff that I forget to mention or some stuff that I don't understand very well. So one of the things that I had to explain people that deep learning is incredibly fashionable subject right now and part of the mystery is probably because people to some degree expected that it works something like human brain, that it should be something incredibly complicated and very mysterious. And in fact, it's not really like this. And we have seen a lot of examples how deep learning is used to do quite incredible things that seem to us, recognizing pictures, recognizing speech, doing other things. And definitely people who are trying to make money with quantitative trading immediately try to see if you can apply it. And the problems that are usually we have to solve in finance are very different from problems that people try to solve when you read articles about it. For example, recognition of the pictures. It's a function, mapping picture to label is a function which is very complicated. We have, for example, 2 to 16 pixels with 3 colors, and we are mapping in some labels. It's a function with very high signal to noise. When you show a person a picture, cat of the dog, everyone knows that it's cat or the dog. The problem that we have in trading is, for example, we have to figure out if the price of the security will go up or down in a while. And unfortunately, signal to noise of such function will be very low, very low. That's under exactly the same circumstances, the price can go up, it can go down, but if we, for example, now that the probability of going up is, let's say, 51 or 52%, it's already pretty good. Even if it's not enough to trade on its own, it's enough to improve trading algorithms that we already have. So the problem is somewhat different. And why is it different? How this, what happens with this? That neural networks usually have a lot of parameters. For example, a simple neural network can have millions of weights. And when we show it, for example, millions of pictures, there's enough information. There's enough information to give some, to change some of these weights. When we do, when we solve problem in trading, especially when we try to trade on the longer terms, first of all, we have a smaller number of returns that we could use, and each of them supplies us a very small number, a very small amount of information. If we just use Shannon definition of this information, like minus probability log of p. So we just don't have enough information to set correspondingly a large number of weights. So the problem is different. Still, it turns out that we can use it in many cases. First of all, we can solve a lot of problems that are not, to begin with, there's a lot of problems that we can solve that not necessarily predicting the returns, but can be useful. Deep learning is pretty good at automating routine, but not very complex for human tasks. And we could extract information from some messy data. For example, you can go through a lot of documents and find out, for example, one of the simple examples that I have seen brings those documents, fill some structured data from these documents. For example, one of the simple examples that was, people could write data in pretty much any format, and neural networks will read it, understand, and put this data in normal data information. There are already systems that could read through documents and extract relevant information, like, for example, how much company was making, and something like this. People are looking for different kind of information. There were a lot of noise a few years ago when people were using the following kind of information. They take a satellite picture of parking lots, for example, in front of in front of the stores and count how many cars parked in front of each store. So they know that some stores can have more consumers than others. So this is typical computer vision problems. We can go through archive of news and mention that, when, for example, archive of news mentions somewhere on Twitter if people like some company more or others. And it's also relevant information, and it's easy. Or we are getting, for example, practical tasks that we had in our case. We get a lot of headlights about some information and filter out some information that is not relevant. That is, for example, somebody already told us that share price of this company went down. This is like 80% of the news. We don't care about it. We can see it from market data. Or, for example, we can predict this to predict some other useful information about stocks not related to the prices, like liquidity, volatility, and other quantities that cannot be easily arbitraged, like a price. I'm sorry, most of here are not related to finance, so I probably have to explain what is arbitrageable price, right? One of the problems in trading is the following. Imagine you have a pretty good way of predicting where the price will go. You're not the only one. There are a lot of people who can use the same prediction. So as soon as some information appears, they can act on this. They announce, for example, that oil will go up today. They immediately act on it. The price goes up, and you cannot use this information again because you are late. This information was arbitraged away. That's why predicting returns is so very difficult. That's why it is very low signal to noise problem. That is. Do I make any sense? It's yes. So we basically, I started working on this problem about a year ago because we just didn't have any program in our company related to neural networks. And at first I would just tell that let's try not to predict returns at first and try to predict other quantities that we can use in trading for the beginning. Then we build up expertise and start doing stuff like this. So here's important problem, that is, it's not really about mathematics or something like this, it's about the general cycle of technologies, that there is some company that Gartner that is doing not very useful focus all the time, but it's just hype cycles that they like to talk about that I actually wanted to explain those students that what could they expect from deep learning that is exactly super popular right now. All technologies comes through the following cycle. At the beginning, comes up with some good idea. No one ever heard about it. No one expects anything from it. Then people start talking about it in the press. They start getting impressed about it. And there is a lot of hype there. And people expect a lot. Like, for example, tomorrow we'll have driving cars. We will have fusion power pretty soon. Pretty soon they start understanding that things are much more complicated. They get disappointed. But only after it is disappointed, they get disappointed, they find that, hey, after all, it is useful for something. In my opinion, and it was end of 2017, and it's not very different right now, I think that deep learning, machine learning is exactly at the hype of the cycle, that is, people expect that they will solve all of the problems. They will see that it is not, there will be disappointment. A lot of people will be fired, a lot of companies will get lost their financing, but if we live through these few years of disappointment, we will find out that they are actually useful for a lot of useful things. And I think the same will go for deep learning. That is, a year ago, everyone was extremely excited that our company is involved in this. Right now, when investors are talking to us, they said, just don't talk to us about deep learning. And I think it will go somewhere like here for a couple of years, and then people will find out that this is actually a very useful technology. We're actually starting to find out that it's useful already now. But it will take some time before other people will find out. And we want to use this period of disappointment when everyone thinks that it's not useful. And here's one thing, how to deal with this hype. One of the problem is people, terminology is somewhat inflated and people expect it to be complicated. It will be much simpler if we use much more technology that is more pedestrian. Instead of using neural layer, we could use something like affine transformation and nonlinearity. There's nothing more to it. Instead of deep learning, we can use Jan LeCun suggested term differential programming. That is, we create our loss function, we can find gradient for our loss function relative to all weights, and we do gradient descent. That's all we do. Instead of artificial intelligence, we could use big fancy regression or big fancy classification. And I'm sorry, this information, this acronym was already used by Elon Musk, but we could use it as well.
What's deep learning?
Deep learning, yes. Deep learning is basically the term that is used right now for neural networks. When you say deep learning, it sounds deep and mysterious, but in fact, it is what's happening. We have some predictor variables. These predictor variables can be, for example, the picture of the cat or the dog. And our network will tell us, is it a cat or a dog? We apply one affine transformation followed by nonlinearity. Another, second, we can have big number of layers. Maybe some neural networks that are used in practice have hundreds of layers like this. In the end, we have output, which will be zero if it is cat and one if it is dog. That's how we built our cat-dog classifiers. There is nothing more to it. As I said, it's very mysterious. People make it sound incredibly mysterious. People make it to feel themselves very important. It is much simpler than that. So neural network is just a complicated function that you have. It's a way to approximate some very complicated functions when you don't really know how we can go from some inputs to some outputs. The usual answer is one way or another, neural network probably will work. And this is another Andrew Ng, who was first at Stanford, then at Baidu, and right now I think he is again at Stanford. He is given a kind of problems that are easily solved by neural networks right now. And basically the idea at this point is, if human can think of some cognitive task, and it will take him on average from 1 to 5 seconds, then with some effort we probably can replace him, this task can be solved with neural network. That is, for example, as I already said, that classify cats and dogs. For example, there are problems like we can find all the human faces. In a picture, we can count number of cars. We can find number of cars on a parking lot. We can do loan application. One of my friends was doing this kind of work 20 years ago, before neural networks were popular, because he didn't know about methods that worked better than that. That we can, for example, do transcription of audio. Then again, we have a complicated function that is sequence of air pressures given by microphone. And in the end, we have to get a token, set of tokens, number of characters in human speech. Yeah, this problem can be done by neural networks right now. They can translate from one language to another, sometimes not very well, with some comic effect, but still it's much better than it could be imagined some time ago. Or, for example, we could record sensors from hard drive, or, for example, from engine of the from plane engine, stuff like this, and give us a warning if it's going to explode. For example, you can see the practical use of this technology. You fly an airplane, you get the information that engine will explode, you shut it down and keep flying on remaining engine as if nothing happened. That's very useful information, and there are billions of dollars can be made in it. And of course, yeah, the one super fashionable technology that people promise a lot of it, that we have sensors in a car, like LIDARs and stuff like this, and it will tell the computer if there's a pedestrian ahead and what we can do with it. But how is it related to, and neural networks is not the only way of doing it. Neural networks are incredibly good if we have, if we have to work with time series or pictures, but there are other methods. If you just have completely unrelated inputs, then very often random forest, gradient boosting, support vector machines for classification, very often they work similarly or better. Very often linear model is good enough. But when you're working with pictures of time series, neural networks really start to shine because they can outperform many of these methods, and they can the structure, you can build neural networks such that it takes into account spatial or time structure of your input. And they have advantages and disadvantages. It was usually considered that to use neural networks, you always need a lot of data. Yes, but actually we found quite a lot of way around it. Very often we can train neural network on unrelated data, and then we have very small amount of data to get it working. they always will benefit from more data. That is one of the problems that I had in our case, that people were building a complicated, very short-term signal model, and they basically, what was happening? They have gigabytes of data. They have linear model. And they throw most of this data away because their model was not getting better with getting more data. Once we started using neural networks, the model could benefit from having more data. Neural networks have more capacity. This is one of those cases when having millions of parameters is good. They're very flexible. You can have different architectures. Support vector machines, I don't know, you probably not doing applied mathematics, so you probably don't know about support vector machines, random forest and other things. Or do you know about this kind of stuff? Okay, it's just not important that it's not the subject. You can always look it up if you're really interested. Other things that you don't need to do feature engineering. That is, for example, usually when people build predictive models, they very stare at something very hard and say, I really should pay attention to this one. With neural networks, the idea is that you can just, you know, throw enough data and neural network will find the hidden structure of this data. And in general, the attractive part about neural networks that very often it happens that you may not be a subject expert, but you can be an expert in neural network, and you can apply it successfully and very often with better success than people who are domain expert for a long time. For example, there is practical use at natural language processing when people look at some text and they try to predict, for example, as is good news, bad news, or something like this. And people found out that there was an ugly saying a few years ago that it's the project will be the more successful the less linguists you have there. Because turns out that neural networks were very often better at finding out that features and interaction between different words that linguists you could found from linguist. Another thing that actually I want to stress, there was this idea from one of the deep learning experts, this Andrei Karpaty, who right now chief of artificial intelligence at Tesla. That is, you can very often you can replace software with neural networks and make it simpler. And we experienced it ourselves. We had one problem, one situation in our company where we were having, we were getting headlines, and we had to classify those headlines as this optimistic or pessimistic headlines about some particular product. We ordered this from some company, and company which were employing linguists and a lot of other people, they came up with a very complicated code that was written in obsolete version of software and was taking something like a few thousand lines. Turns out that we could replace it with network that was something like 15 lines of code and had better precision. So basically, many thousands lines of code were replaced by matrices. You just do matrix instead of the computer, instead of interpreting one piece of code by another, it's just doing multiplication of matrices, and it basically comes up with better result. So it's to some degree revolutionary because this code is much easier to maintain and it can give better results. And the idea is that it's just different way of constructing software. You don't write it. You write multiplication of matrices, supply it with the right weights, and it's doing what you need. How do you do this? Multiplication of matrices to do with weights, we'll be to later. This is the problem with you can expect problems with neural networks. This is one of classical examples of what kind of mistakes they can make. The idea was to show neural networks a lot of pictures and they create description. Always when people were showing the pictures of a ship, it was, you know, in mountains with a lot of green, pastures. So the neural network just figured out that once we see green pastures, that's where ships should be. So that's, you see, there's no ships here, but that's how neural network interprets it. You have to expect this kind of problems. So what it is? As I said, it's nothing more than matrix multiplication, and there are a lot of different kinds of possible architectures. How does it look here? I will show here. So if you could see that, for example, in one of those examples, doesn't matter where there is we have, for example, this, we could, for example, in this network, we have inputs, we have this affine transformation, after which we apply nonlinearity. Some of this input goes to next layer, then we again apply nonlinearity, another one. All of this can basically be described in some of the computer language that, you know, I have input, I multiply by matrix, I apply nonlinearity like TonH or something like this, and here we go. The whole zoo of architectures. The simplest one is what they called multi-layer perceptron. That's just the simplest network. This is one, for example, that people could use if they predict like credit risk. They could input all kind of information here. Input layer can be anything, like age, zip code, salary, also a lot of information that people are told should not be entering, but they enter anyway, or can be implied otherwise. That is, how many times he was defaulting, something like this. Then they apply matrix multiplication here, and apply nonlinearity here. Then they do it again. There's not enough space on this picture, but you can do it, for example, 10 layers, or 20 layers, or 30 layers. Turns out that the more layers you have, the more expressive your network can be. And then you do, well, here, that's basically, we'll have these two numbers. And which number of these numbers is bigger? For example, class one will be that, yes, this guy will return his money that he borrowed. This guy will be that he will not return. And yes, as strange it may seem, this simple architecture works. There are all kind of different nonlinearity functions. This is the most popular. Classical neural networks were using this sigmoid because people at that time were thinking that this is approximates behavior of our neurons. That is, you apply some kind of excitation and it goes into other states, then it's saturated. So they thought if it works in brain, it should be working as well. Right now, we know that our neural networks are very different from what happening in brain, but brain was the original inspiration. Later, people found out that it's very difficult to train these new networks with more than two layers with this kind of excitation, because after you are from somewhere here, the gradient goes to zero, and the gradient just doesn't propagate more than one or two layers. And right now, absolute majority of networks is using this kind of nonlinearity. It is basically you get, after you apply your matrix, you just, everything that less than zero, you set to zero. And you keep continuing it. And yes, it works. There are other ones, less popular, sometimes they work a bit better, but the difference is not huge. Another kind of network would be convolutional neural network, which is used for processing time series and images. Why it is interesting, why it is different? In the network that I showed, for you, it didn't really know about spatial, for example, it didn't know about spatial structure. So if you go here, imagine that we measure some sensor in time, that we measure, try to predict weather, and we look at the temperature and wind. We take it here, like many days ahead of time. But in this matrix, it doesn't see any difference between this and this input. Also, we know, for example, that yesterday is probably much more important. Convolutional network are very popular for processing pictures and sequences, and they're working like this, that basically, again, this will be matrix multiplication on a small scale, like two inputs, which goes into this one layer. We could do something like nonlinear transformation here, then we do it again, then we, for example, this is another kind of nonlinearity. Instead of adding those numbers, we just take max of them. It's another kind of nonlinearity. We go through a few layers, and in the end is our output. This kind of neural network is different because pixels or time series that are close to each other, they are more related than others in this structure. And it's very efficient for processing time sequences and images. Oh, recurrent neural networks is work in somewhat different way. That is basically, you have some input, and you have few matrix multiplications here, nonlinearities. The result will be some kind of output and a hidden state. The next will have exactly the same kind of process, the same set of matrices with the same weights. It's again will produce some kind of state, some output, and next state. So it's again something that can be worked, for example, to predicting weather, or for predicting next word in a sentence, or something like this. A lot of possibilities. And these are very popular structures to solve this kind of problems. And again, I will not write all these formulas here. I just don't have time, and it's all over the place in Wikipedia and stuff like this. So fitting is, again, is done in a very simple way. That is, you have to produce, you have weights of the network. You can have, for example, a million of parameters or 10 million. Some of them have 10 billions of parameters. And you have loss function. And loss function can be pretty much anything, like difference of squares between predicting value and value that you want. Or, for example, if it's classification, it will be, for example, binomial cross entropy. Anything, any kind of loss function you write down. And you do it, you have to calculate derivative of loss function relative to those parameters. And you don't have to write down with a pen for all those million parameters. Existing frameworks will do it for you. They will do it very efficiently, they will do it on GPU, and will do it calculations. And the calculation of this parameter is done by gradient descent, and not on the whole data you do, but on small set of batches. For example, you get your 100 points, you calculate your loss function for the 100 points, you descend it. Then you get another hundreds of points, difference that you haven't seen yet, you again descend. And here's the thing, if you're pretty far from your minimum, pretty much all this descent will be happening in the same direction. Once you get to the minimum, it will be jumping all over the place. It's okay. It's actually, turns out that parameters of this stochastic gradient descent, they are quite crucial to how neural network will be performing. It's not just that you solve this problem, like in linear algebra, for example, you have this matrix, you have this predictors, you have output. Once you solve it, it doesn't matter how you solve, the result will be the same. Here, the result will be very different on what parameters that you use. And the big change that neural network created compared to previous methods was the following, that, you know, once you try to predict something, you work very hard, you try to come up with different features, that is, what your kernel size, and, you know, you say a lot of words that no one else will understand, come up with different loss function. With neural networks, the whole approach is usually like this. That is, you don't know how to solve problem, you add more layers, it works. It fits my observation. That's how it works. That's one of the reasons why neural networks are not very popular with people who, with deep thinkers. They very often are offended, and they have a good reason to. So here's another interesting point about this. We have this very complicated function. We have loss function. We try to optimize our parameters to come up with it. Mathematicians always say that it's a very complicated function. It's probably non-convex. You cannot just use gradient descent because you will not find the global maximum. We don't care about global maximum. Why we don't global? We have some data.
How many parameters?
Here, in this particular was a couple of million of parameters. But here's the thing. We don't care about global maximum. Why we don't care about global maximum? We have some data, example data, and we try to predict some data that we didn't see. If we find global maximum of our loss function on our data, we ideally fit it to our data that we already see. But it doesn't say about how well the prediction will work on the data that we have not seen. This is a very simple example, for example, that it was actually classification of sentences. So the loss function was going down. The blue one is the loss function for in sample data, the data that we use for training. The yellow is error for data that we have not seen yet. So what is happening is that it's a typical situation in machine learning that we keep fitting. At some point we overfit. What happens is that we keep improving on the data that we already see, but this already means that we probably paying attention to the things that are not important. For example, again, if you get back to our example like cats and dogs, for example, it may happen that in our data, cats are always looking to the right and dogs to the left. It may start using this feature. This calls overfit. We don't want that. So basically, this also shows that we are not really interested in global minimum here. So it's not a big deal that our method is not guaranteed to find global minimum. It's okay. So yeah, the problem is that neural networks are always overparameterized. Very often they have much more parameters than we have examples. So we always have to think about regularization, somehow to predict overfit. So the method, turns out that optimization method, stochastic gradient descent, is already a regularizer. That if you do it with small batches, you will have data that are pretty much regularized. But of course, the best way to regularize data is to use more data. Data is the best regularizer. The more data you have, the best it regularized. The problem is very often you don't have enough data for your problem. Then you can use data from different problem. So you can train your problem. So again, you have this structure of neural network that is complicated. You can train your model. You can train your model, for example, on some unrelated but similar task. But then what you do, you can fix those weights and change only this small number of weights and see if your problem is will work. How does it work in practice? Let's show me a couple of examples. So for example, we can classify, we can use our network to classify sentences, but you don't have a lot of, you have to have a lot of people that say that this sentence, for example, is politically correct and this is not politically correct or whatever. It's expensive. So instead, we are trying to train our system to predict next word. Or for example, you have a lot of pictures, you can remove part of the pictures and try, and network will predict the rest of the picture. You can add noise and teach neural network remove this noise. All this kind of exercises that are done on a lot of data that are cheap, and then you use it for your data. For example, one of good papers that was a year ago was the following. Facebook had billions of pictures which don't have any description. But we know that people are usually predict put pictures in normal rotation. So what they do, they randomly rotate those pictures, and then neural network just trying to predict, is this picture looking upright, or it's rotated left or right? So we can have four possible labels in this kind of examples. Turns out that to do this task, neural networks is using features that are later will be very useful for predicting what kind of picture it is. So they could pre-train, do this training, like on 2 billions of pictures, trying to predict orientation. Then they take few thousand of pictures that are labeled, that for example, dogs, cats, people, human, birds, something like this. And this network turns out to be much more efficient than if it was not trained on all kind of this data. Another very, very interesting technique that is probably not very evident for people with mathematical background is dropout. You have the structure of neural network. These are inputs. These are our affine layer with nonlinearity, and this is how it works. What we do is, this is actually one of the best and very efficient methods. We randomly drop these connections. That is basically, when we do this batch of data, we basically forbid data to propagate in this direction, and basically, and correspondingly back propagation of derivatives. So each time when we train it, it's a different network. And then we efficiently average in all kind of possible network with this. We randomly drop how signal can propagate with it. So instead of, for example, having this network with 5 and 5 layers each time, we'll have network with 2 or 3 layers. Turns out, yes, this is method that there was theoretical work, which is not completely conclusive, but the experiment is that the data that work with this way, they are much more, they work much better on the data that neural network have not seen yet, on auto-sample data, than if you don't use this method. And you have to come up with what kind of loss you have. It's also important. That is, for example, in finance, one of the problems, we try to predict future return. They are very fat-tailed. So we can have the majority of returns over day maybe within 1%, but sometimes you will have 10%. And if you try to predict, use normal least square loss, neural network has millions of parameters. It definitely will have enough parameters to dedicate to this particular point, spend a lot of effort trying to fit exactly this point, which is not important. You will never see this example again. So it turns out that using something like classifier, that is just to know if the price will go up or down, in which case there is not a lot of difference between price going up 1% and 10%, is in the long run is a better idea. Or you can use other type of losses that, again, if you have experience with data analysis, financial mathematics, you probably will recognize, like Huber loss, mean absolute square error, something like this probably will be better. Or another thing is it turns out that if instead of predicting not only return, but also sigma of your distribution, it also will be much better idea. And replace with classification when you can. If you can use classifier. This is how standard classifier. If, for example, you have many different layers, you have this 5, 10 thousand layers. One of classifiers I was working with had 100,000 outputs. It was a classifier that was trying to predict the next word. So you have 10,000 numbers here. For each of them, you do this kind of softmax. You raise this number to exponent and divide by sum of exponents. Whichever has the biggest number, that wins. That's the kind of stuff that you predict. And very often you can, the result is depend on, instead of before you classify something, you just try to predict what you ask. For example, there was a problem some time ago. NVIDIA tried to solve the problem. We have a drone which is flying in a forest. Let's teach it to find a trail. And okay, actually, I could imagine that 5-10 years ago, no one could even think how to approach this problem. And again, how really can you teach a robot just to follow a trail? It's a complicated problem. Can you describe it, for example, this program? Do you remember when I was talking about software 2.0, that instead of writing a lot of complicated code, that when I see three here, you turn left, when you see three here, you turn right, it's complicated, you can never do it. Instead, we replace it with weights. But what kind of problem you try to solve? And they approached it in a very simple way. So they came up with, again, the important part in all this engineering was to come up with what kind of loss function you do. They had a hiker with a hat with three cameras. The camera looks front, left, right. And they show all this picture to neural network. And it's trying to classify it. Is was done by cameras that looks in front? Is it looks by cameras that looks to the left or cameras that looks to the right? And basically, if it's similar to pictures that you look to the right, it's just the drone should turn left. If it's done by picture done to the left, it just drone should turn to the right. If it's the same camera as you can see in front, just keep going. And just by posing this problem in such a simple way, they could solve it with neural network and get a drone that can follow trail in the forest and pretty easy. And actually, it's a very complicated problem if you think about it. All machines could do it. This is already talking that you don't have to do feature engineering, it just comes up with them. Yes, so the question is how do we get input into our data? With continuous variables, it's very simple. It's just a good idea to scale them all to approximately the same scale so that once you calculate derivatives will be on the same scales. Otherwise, what will happen is that if gradient is big for one variable, it just will spend all the time on optimizing this variable and won't work on others, and you will have to wait for a long time. Just from the point of optimality, the best thing is to have them all on one scale. And it will figure out something. Of course, if you know that some kind of feature is relevant, it's good to give it. Neural networks are perfectly capable of figuring out time from pictures of the clocks, but if you give it, for example, you know, just location of the arrow, like sine of time, cosine of the time, it will learn faster. So if you can transform your data into a form that is useful neural network, it will just learn it faster. It's more complicated what you do if you have discrete inputs. For example, one of the tasks, if you have sentence, you have different words and you want to predict next word or next character. And the best solution that people came up with is embedding, that is each discrete variable is represented by vector in n-dimensional space. And it's a very useful approach, which is actually can be used for many different things. That is, for example, this is example how the words are represented. When people tried, again, the task is the following. We have recurrent neural networks, the kind of what I'm showing you. It gets some input. The output is classifier of 100,000 outputs. It's trying to predict next word. Once you look at it, it turns out that all the words located in space and they actually have some kind of The structure of the space is actually something that can that's interesting. For example, you could see that all the lines from number of the country to the number of the capital, they are approximately parallel. So you could, for example, go from one to one. You could go, for example, find the difference between Russia and Moscow. Then you find Turkey, apply the same vector that it did, and you will get war somewhere close to Ankara. So the input will be recurrent neural networks, as I already showed you. There is. So each of the inputs will be this kind of multidimensional vector. You have a couple of matrix multiplication, something like this, and you have some kind of state. And this will predict the next word. You get the next word, which again will be some kind of in multidimensional space, and you do the same thing. And this is what is usually done in natural language processing, but applications are much more wide. You can predict a lot of things with it. Any kind of sequence of discrete variables, you could do it. So Netflix was using it for predicting which next movie to recommend. So each movie is embedded in multidimensional space, is fed in neural network, and each user also is represented by multidimensional vector. They fed a neural network like this. It gives you basically distribution of, let's say, 1,000 movies. It gives you some kind of distribution of a kind of movies that you want to see. It will recommend you this movie, this movie, this movie. Discrete information like day of the week or season, you can feed it on neural network, and it also will be some kind of variable. And it's, again, we are able to build models that actually becomes very expressive. Going back to our problem of predicting stocks, we can build models that will be the same model, but we can have additional inputs indeed, what day of week it is, or something like this. With credit card fraud detection, it's a similar problem. You can see, I was talking about how to predict next word, but it's the same thing. That is, for each person, you can have a usual series of stories it goes. Each story is represented again by multidimensional vector, and it predicts what kind of stories it can go next. If it goes into something that is very unlikely, well, it may be a fraud. It can be detected like this. But you can just go ahead and come up. This is just kind of examples that we were solving in our case. That is, this information, it's called again, that is, when we talk about sentences, that is, people usually talk about it like sentiment classification, but it's not necessarily, you know, like positive or negative sentiments. That, for example, in this case, it's just from our firm, it's just, we had to figure out what kind of sentences can have are relevant for our analysis and which are not. And just some person was going through it, just labeled about 1,000 of them, and we get a model that is working fairly well. And what is good about this kind of approach, that is, when all this information is embedded, all of these features are embedded into this kind of multidimensional space. In this case, we had only about 1,000 sentences to build this model. And we got a neural network that works very well. But why we did this? Because we already had these vectors that were trained on billions of words on language models. The language model was just trying to predict the next word in the sentence. So this is actually a lot of information. This actually, we had 300 dimensions by 100,000 words. Someone did this work for us. The result is very interesting. We can have a word that never was in our training set, but because its synonym is very close to it in multidimensional space, because neural network already could see the synonym of this word, it could immediately see that we replace this word with something different. For example, it could see EU instead of Eurozone, and it works exactly the same. So this is one of the ways why this kind of representation of discrete variables is incredibly useful for neural networks. So, yeah, there's a lot of things that can be done with natural language processing. As turns out, as we figured out, that they are all very interesting, but not super useful for finance, but a very, very useful way for practicing neural networks. Yeah, one of the works that I One of the examples that I could probably suggest that I just didn't have data set, but was interesting. I think you have heard the story how people were looking at N numbers, tail numbers of airplanes that were transporting, flying from one airport to another, and they found a series of airplanes with very unusual routes. As they started to investigate, and it was airplanes that were CIA was used to transfer people for torture. And if you can think about it, it can be exactly transformed into this kind of NLP problem. You have series of ID for airports, you have series of ID for airplanes. Each of them will be represented by a multi-dimensional vector. You build a neural network that will predict next airport airplane will be going to. And each of these airplanes and airports will be represented by some vector in multi-dimensional space. Those airplanes that are, for example, flying normal commercial flights, they will be going from one airport to another, here, back again. They will have one model, and they will have somewhere in this space, part of phase space. Those that are doing, for example, flying somewhere from Syria to Poland or something like this, they will something like this. I think we will have a lot of applications doing like this. And this is a problem that is very similar to the ones that you do in language processing, even if it's not immediately looks like this.
So you say that the CIA flights were detected by the neural networks?
They were not. We could use it for it. It was detected by neural networks, that's here.
Okay.
But if you need to do it automatically, there were thousands of volunteers just going through databases, and they spotted this very weird pattern. But we don't have thousands of volunteers for each kind of problems. This is one of the ways you could do it.
Okay.
And you could do any kind of clicks, any kind of different applications. Why Google and Facebook are so interested? They basically look at sequence of clicks people are doing on kind of advertisement. And again, what websites you clicked it? Each website is represented, it's a categorical variables, it's represented by a multi-dimensional vector. You try to predict next one, you have this model. You have your smartphone in your pocket. It measures accelerator. From this, basically, it can classify a sequence of accelerations. It can figure out, are you running, are you walking, stuff like this. There's something like people are basically turning on just to see if they are doing enough exercise, something like this. And this information has a lot of other applications. So you record sound from airplane turbine, as I said. You just send it to this kind of sequence analyzer as well. Will it fail or not? Or you could look at electrocardiogram, and again, this is the best way to classify electrocardiograms right now. That is it something like a healthy person or not? People were using it, for example, for gravitational wave detection, and I had a side project to detect planet transit in front of star that I have not finished. But again, this kind of stuff can be done. Anytime you can think about classification of sequences, you can do it. And if you have continuous variables, you just feed them as vector. If you have categorical variables, you just come up with some kind of embedding and do the same problem as you for processing words. And the output of network can be, for example, classifiers, you say it, next four, something like this, or it can be multidimensional vectors that can be fed into another neural network, and which can be fed in another network, and it will be, you know, turtles all the way down, as there was the story. That is, there are many ways of combining. For example, you can have car where you have image that neural networks gives you, is there a pedestrian inside, and the output of it will be, or where the pedestrian is, will be multi-dimensional vector, which just describes all the scene around it, which is fed into, there are other neural networks that decides what we should do now. So they can be composed almost indefinitely. You can have systems that is built from tens of thousands of different neural networks, and all of them can be optimized with gradient descent at the same time. So, in general, I'm sure that it was, I just dipped a little bit about it. And again, once you have this kind of time processing things, you can feed all kind of market information in it. You could feed, for example, an example that we were drawing, you could feed fundamental information about company, for example, price to earning, that is how much, what dividends they had, something like this, and try to predict will they increase or decrease next time. It's not a very good model, but it works better than linear models. You could feed into a sequence of prices, including microstructure, like what the volume is right now, are people more buying than selling, something like this, to predict future returns. It's quite a lot of possibilities, which I cannot go into a lot of details now, just because, not only because we just started in our company now, but whatever we know, we unfortunately cannot divulge very much. But I think the takeaway from here is that all this neural network area is much less mysterious than it's usually described. It's just in the end is you just have to able to multiply matrices and take gradients. And you have to automate it to avoid doing it by hand. And you can solve quite a lot of interesting problems. And most of these problems is the kind of problems you can solve is limited not by complexities by neural networks, but what kind of can you think about solving the questions, how to do it? For example, I read, I don't know how to do it, was the following application. That is, there are automatical theorem provers these days that you, if you convert your theorem in some kind of machine learnable format, computer will check the proof and check if it's correct or not. I never worked with them. I don't know really how they work, but I know they exist. But the problem is that not theorems are worth proving because most of them are not interesting. So just like you predicted next word in a sentence, people could come up with a method of you have this theorem, you embed it, you create some kind of neural network that transforms the theorem described in machine learning language in some kind of multi-dimensional vector. Then you basically look at what kind of theorems, you basically could just go through some kind of textbook and see that as a structure of theorems, which next theorem would a mathematician try to find after that. And it could come up with new hypotheses. It could build new theorems that it would try to fit to automatic theorem provers. Of course, it would be quite a lot of this would be inefficient, but it still would be much more efficient than just come up with this hypothesis by random chance, because it just would be, first of all, it would be too much work in computers, and second, most of them would not be interesting. So what I want to say is basically, we never know what it can be applied for. Most of the application of neural networks will be done not by machine learning experts, but by people who work in their corresponding field, because they know what questions have to be asked. After that, you could ask, you could see it, what kind of typical problems are solved and try to apply them to your field. For example, at some point, people who were trying to predict fraud, they didn't even think that this problem is somehow to relate to natural language processing. Just after they read some article, someone came up, oh, I see this problem, I can interpret it in a different way. And turns out, yeah, you could use methods that already exist there, you could use for that. So it's actually, it's probably overhyped, it's probably super popular, but I think that after a while, this will become a very interesting and powerful method for solving many kinds of problems, many of kind of problems that we don't know about yet. So if you're interested in subject, I think that basically one of the simple things for people who are not involved in it before, who were not involved in it, who are not machine learning experts, would be, first of all, there is this good book by François Cholet, which is, again, you are not expected to know much more than do some simple programming in Python and, again, understand differentiation. And if you go to this website, fast.ai, there's a pretty good video and interactive course that was actually targeted at people who just finished college and not necessarily even had master program or something, but can do a little bit of programming, which is, I went through this course with enjoy. I had a lot of fun going through this because they start solving quite interesting problems very fast, like, for example, trying to find faces and different objects in images, or again, predicting next word in a sentence. And it's actually very fun. So once you played with it, maybe you will come up with a way of using it for some kind of problems that no one ever thought about it. Because I think that most of progress in machine learning will be not from coming with new architectures, but from people who know something about subjects and they can think about some way of doing it. And I probably didn't answer about any kind of Unfortunately, I didn't have any kind of questions, but basically I think that ask me anything, because I think I missed quite a lot, and quite a lot of things was not really, was either too simple or maybe you didn't understand me. That's probably two possibilities. Because again, I don't know this audience very well. So, anything?
Questions?
So, in your experience in the financial industry, which methods are very popular?
Absolute majority of what's happening in finance is just simple linear model. Simple linear models. You basically have some predictors. For example, this company, for example, made slightly more, their dividend was slightly more, we should buy it. This dividend was less than expected, we sell it. Absolute majority of models are simple linear model. Either linear regression or logistic regression. Right now, they are starting to use neural networks and other nonlinear methods such as gradient boosting or something like this. One of the companies, Two Sigma, is actually very active in hiring a lot of people from Google, spending a lot of money on building their own, what they called artificial intelligence department. And frankly, I think it is a problem. They probably will have some problem because, first of all, as I should have mentioned, it's not really artificial intelligence, it's artificial instinct at best. It's still very useful. It shouldn't be called artificial intelligence. Once people call it artificial intelligence, they put too much hope on it. They really hope that they can be as intelligent as people. At best, it is artificial instinct. You shouldn't underestimate it. Artificial instinct is incredibly useful. That is, you know that insects can build very complicated structures. We would be much more complicated than any machines we can do. If we could get artificial instinct working reliably, it will be a huge advance. But here's the thing, that there was quite a lot of hype about artificial intelligence, about using neural networks in finance about a year ago. I think it's starting to die down. Because most of the company tried, they failed. Basically, they letting quite a lot of people who are doing it off. I think they are wrong, because if you go there with low expectations and expecting a long walk, you can achieve a lot. We already have models that are doing some predictions. We already have some strategies that are making money. They are not making money like billions yet, but we are improving every day, and I think we, if you remember this curve that I explained to you, inflated expectations and going down, that is, I think we can ride this going down and arise on the other end. But the problem is that with many of these approaches, you have to dedicate a lot of time to it. You cannot just come up with and come up with working strategy in a week. So I'm not sure if I answered your questions. So basically, most of financial companies are using linear models. They are starting to use nonlinear models. Some are successful, majority are not. There's a lot of disappointment for it, but it's still a very useful technology.
Do people use sentiment analysis?
Sorry? Yes, they're using quite a lot of this sentence analysis. They analyze sentiment, they're buying this kind of stuff. Unfortunately, they find out that even if they can't find sentiment of their news very well, it's not extremely good at predicting future returns. But it's maybe useful in another sense. Once you have some news that is very important for the company, you may want to go out of the market immediately. You may want to stop trading it. So it's useful for risk reduction. I'm sorry, that was your question.
Yeah, so I work in topology, and in topology we associate numbers or algebraic invariants to shapes, mm-hmm. to distinguish them,
uh-huh.
or to classify them.
Uh-huh.
Right. So I was wondering if any similar techniques have been used in machine learning or in studying neural networks?
I have no idea. It's probably is incredibly interesting. Unfortunately, I'm not an expert. This basically, I'm absolutely.
You look at the combinatorics of the shapes.
Yes.
And try to extract very simple.
Every relationship is there. In general, neural networks, especially the ones that are working on these discrete symbols, they are pretty good at finding a hidden structure. They will not be, you know, they are to some degree probabilistic, so you cannot count on the fact that if it found some kind of relationship, it will be 100% sure, but it can be a good indication where to look. If you try to do something, there is probably good chance you will find it. I have no idea how to approach it. This is one of those examples that, again, without knowing anything about topology, I would say that it's an interesting area. You should just go through those completely courses as a complete beginners and try it. No one but you will be able to do it. That's why I say that most of the application of machine learning will be in people who are not machine learning experts, but who are working in the field and using their methods. Try it.
Yeah, and what about the backpropagation methods in order to feed the weights in a neural network?
Well, I'm actually, again, I went through, when I studied it, I went through backpropagation a few times. I don't think I will write down it for you right now because, again, it's something that was done many times, and frankly speaking, I will not derive it for you because I don't remember. Well, I went through it a few times. I forget it because you don't need it most of the time because, again, most of these frameworks are doing it for you. Definitely, once people came up with backpropagations, they found a way to find these derivatives much more efficiently than they could before. But it's all in a framework. I don't have to remember it, and I'm sorry. I'm not really a mathematician at this point. I'm doing applied mathematics. But it's so easy to find. It's so easy to find anywhere.
Also, probably through the several layers, you can have a good classifier.
Yes.
But what about the dynamics? Usually in finance, time is very
important. Correct.
So if you have a classifier in a given moment, probably it can be good in our.
Yes. So what you want to say is that the models are changing with the time. Right, so it's basically the model that was working today,
yeah.
It will be working much worse. Yes, so basically we have two opposing tendencies right now. If you want to fit the model that is working in the same regime like now, so we probably want to train only on recent data. On the other hand, we may not have enough data to train our model because there's just not enough data. So we did a lot of experiments with this, and basically, we basically have very detailed market data back to 2010. In our experience, the more data you throw at it, the better model works, which is, by the way, very different from linear models. Linear models have a small capacity. It's usual that you have to train it on recent 1 or 2 years of data. And if you use period going back further, it just will try to the market just was behaving in a different way previously, so it just won't behave the same way now. With neural networks, we found different behavior. That is, the more data we throw at it, the better it works. I don't have very good explanation for this. It's probably with higher capacity, it can probably distinguish between different regimes much better. But it may be very different in different problems. As I say, I'm talking about only about my experience, and quite a lot of this, unfortunately, work is not theoretic, but very experimental. Even people who are doing machine learning theory, very often they actually doing experiments.
More questions? Well, many thanks.